Hey guys, welcome to DevTech Finance. In this video, we would be covering the topic accounting concepts and conventions. So before going on to understand what are all the concepts and conventions we will be talking about, first let's understand what exactly is the difference between the accounting concepts and the conventions. So accounting concepts have been established by professional organizations and are standard principles that must be followed when preparing financial accounts. So this line you need to keep in mind is that these are standard principles and these must be followed. So whenever the accountants are preparing the financial reporting, financial accounts to be presented, they need to keep this in mind and they need to follow this because these are established by professional organizations which need to be followed by every financial accounting organization before preparing the accounts. So concepts thus are different from conventions. We will see what conventions are. So accounting conventions are generally accepted practices. Now there is difference between principles and practices. Practices are followed whereas principles have to be followed. They must be followed. So conventions are generally accepted practices that can change and are updated over time, depending upon the requirement in financial reporting. So because of the convenient and being observed that these conventions are good for the accounting purpose, these are followed. But these are not mandatory and these can be changed and updated over time as per the requirement in financial reporting. So now when we have understood the difference between accounting concepts and conventions, we will now try to look after what all our accounting concepts and conventions being followed in our accounting system. So let's start. First, we will be talking about accounting concepts. So the first is separate entity concept, going concern concept, money measurement concept, cost concept, dual aspect concept, accounting period concept, and matching concept. So these all concepts we will be learning about one by one. So let's start with the separate entity concept. According to this, business is considered as a separate legal entity which has its distinct identity separate from its owner. Okay, so whenever business is formed, the owner and the business must be treated as separate entities. They must not be seen as single person. Okay, so business is having its own legal identity. Now this concept, why is it extremely useful in accounting? It is because it helps in keeping business affairs strictly free from the private affairs of owner. So this is like whenever owner is putting capital in business, that capital is solely for business purpose and it's not that owner can use it for private purposes as well. No, that capital is to be used for the business purpose and growth of business. Thus, business need to be treated as legal entity, a separate entity from its owner. Now, this is also the reason why withdrawal by owner from business is treated as drawing. Okay, we have generally observed that whenever we record transaction related to owner which has taken money out of the business for its private purpose, we treat it as drawing. The drawing that owner has taken out from the business fund, from the business money, which need to be paid by the owner. The second is going concern concept. According to this concept, it is assumed that business is established and will continue for a fairly long time in future. So whenever any business is established, it is not for a shorter period of time. It is assumed that the business will have a longer survival in the market. And this is the reason why when we are recording transaction related to assets, while valuing assets of firm, current resale value is not taken into account. Instead, depreciation is charged on basis of their expected life. Because whenever we are valuing assets in accounting, we know that the assets we have acquired, that is to run the business, to help the business in production purpose, etc. It's not to resale the assets, and thus we do not record the asset value according to the current market value. We record it at cost value and then we keep on charging depreciation over the time, whatever is the useful time period of that particular asset. So this is the basis, the going concern concept, according to which the accounting transactions are also governed. The business is meant to be survived for a longer period of time. Third is money measurement concept. According to this concept, accounting should necessarily record only those transactions which can be expressed in monetary terms. So, only the quantitative transactions are recorded in accounting and qualitative facts are not recorded, like any change in management are not recorded in books of account. There are many other qualitative factors which may influence the business, but that is not recorded in accounting. Accounting is only concerned with monetary transactions and only those transactions are recorded. Then there is cost concept. This concept is closely related to going concern concept. So we already studied about going concern concept, and cost concept is generally related to it because it emphasizes that assets should be recorded at its cost price and not the market price, which keeps on changing. So whenever we are taking any asset for business purpose, it must be recorded at the cost price. And then the depreciation could be charged, but it should not be recorded with the market price because those assets are not meant for resale purpose. And thus, if we would be recording it at the market value, we may be estimating the money in our business over or under. So to keep that in mind, the recordings are made according to the cost, the book value of the asset. Then there is dual aspect concept. The dual aspect concept states that every business transaction requires recordation in two different accounts. So the concept is derived from the accounting equation which states that asset equal liabilities plus equity. So dual aspect concept says that every debit will have a credit account, and thus your asset side should be equal to the liability side. And this is the reason why in balance sheet, we always see that total amount of asset listed must be equal to the combination of liabilities and equity. So liabilities is what you have to pay back, what you owe, and equity is the capital you have put and assets you have acquired. So it may be current assets and fixed assets, but the value should be same because you have utilized all the liability and equity to acquire those assets. Thus, it should remain at the same value, and this is what dual aspect concept says. Now see, for example, that the business have borrowed 10,000 rupees from Mr. XYZ. Now how this recording of this transaction would be done? According to this, now as a result of this transaction, asset side in form of cash or bank will increase by 10,000. Of course, because we have borrowed 10,000 rupees from Mr. XYZ, now our business will be having a debit of cash or bank account by rupees 10,000. But at the same time, we will have to record it as liability, and that liability will increase by 10,000 in form of creditor which need to be paid back to Mr. XYZ, and hence that would be a credit account. And thus we can see that for the debit account, we are also creating a credit account. Now let's talk about accounting period concept. According to this concept, accounting should measure transactions at regular intervals for a specified period of time called accounting period. So accounting period is generally necessary to evaluate the financial performance, the transactions recording, and to check out whether the recordings are as per the business transactions or not. So a specified accounting period is necessary in any business. And necessary financial disclosures and reporting need to be made at the end of each accounting period. Now, this accounting period could be quarterly, half yearly, or yearly, depending upon the company's requirement and their policies and procedures. But a specified period must be defined because you need to make financial disclosures and reporting to assess the financial situation of the business. Then there is matching concept. This concept is also known as periodic matching of cost and revenue. According to this concept, profits made by business in particular accounting period can be ascertained only when revenues earned during the period are compared with the expenses incurred in earning that revenue. So we can't just to look over the revenues for the period. We also need to analyze the expenses, because expenses are nothing but the cost which we are paying to earn that revenue. Now, after analyzing both the revenue and expenses, then only we can decide what is the profit made by the business in any particular financial period or accounting period. And this is what matching concept says, to depend on both cost and revenue and not just a single criteria to judge the business performance. Now, let's see some of the accounting conventions. So first is conservatism, second is full disclosure, third is consistency, and fourth is materiality. As we already discussed, conventions are the practices that can be followed. These are not mandatory, but these are suggested because it makes accounting processes more reliable and satisfactory. So let's start with understanding these accounting conventions. So first is convention of conservatism. According to this convention, the accountants have to follow the rule: anticipate no profit, provide for all possible losses while recording business transactions to meet uncertainty efficiently. So this says that you can't anticipate profits. Only when profit is realized, only when you have made the transaction and you have earned the profit, then only you need to record that profit. But for losses, you need to anticipate the losses that maybe you can occur this amount of loss. And for you must have seen in accounting transaction that for this convention of conservatism, the provisions are created, which we usually see the provisions for bad and doubtful debts, reserves are created. All these are to meet uncertainties because we anticipate losses in future. Second is convention of full disclosure. According to this convention, there should be adequate disclosure of all material information in the financial statements prepared for stakeholders like investors, creditors, government, etc. So full disclosure is quite similar what we discussed in that accounting period concept, because we need to specify a period in which we will be reviewing our financial statements and we will be making financial disclosures and reporting to check out all the transactions to match the financial performance, and thus it becomes necessary to make material information, useful information disclosed in front of the stakeholders, because stakeholders are one who are holding interest in your business and who are the main core for the business success and growth. So investors, creditors, government, financial disclosure need to be made. Then there is convention of consistency. According to this convention, it is essential that accounting procedures and methods should remain unchanged from one accounting period to another to facilitate comparison. So this is suggested that consistency should be maintained when we are adopting any accounting procedure, any method for any particular transaction. So that should be made consistent within the period to make sure that we can facilitate comparison year on year. So for example, if material issued are priced on the basis of FIFO method, that is first in, first out method, so the same should be followed thereafter also to keep the accounting procedure consistent and to make the comparison more easier. So another example could be when we are following the depreciation method, the straight line method, so that should be followed. Another methods like written down value method, changing the methods create a havoc in the accounting transactions and thus are not suggested. Then the last is convention of materiality. According to this convention, the accountant should attach importance to material details or facts and ignore insignificant ones. So only those recording transactions should be done who consist of material facts, who are of importance to the business, and insignificant ones should be ignored. Other than that, we also discussed that only quantitative and the transactions that can be measured in terms of money should be recorded. So in the absence of this distinction, if we are recording immaterial facts also, what will happen? Accounting will unnecessarily be complex and burdened with minute details. So for example, there are many factors like increase in competition, change in demand pattern, which impacts business performance, but we can't record all those facts. We only record the quantitative transactions which can be measured, which can be analyzed, which can be recorded, which are significant and of value to them, to the business recordings. Thank you for watching. Do like and share my video. Subscribe to my channel, DevTech Finance. Thank you all.